questions. I just noticed a little news item. Sorry. Okay? Is that all right? Okay. We're getting ready for questions. I have a news item here from the New York Times last month that there a report to Defense Secretary Frank Colucci by a study group of the Defense Science Board, quote, an influential advisory group whose members come from industry and academia, which has urged the Pentagon to assert influence over economic policy. This is news. To head off, quote, an increasing loss of technological leadership to both allies and adversaries. And this is the latest in a series of reviews by the military-industrial complex conducted this year by things like the Congressional Office of Technology Assessment, the Air Force Association, the National Defense University, and so on, that are all urging the Pentagon to exert more influence over taxes, trade laws, environmental regulation, and education in order to protect the military-industrial complex. And the New York Times reporter says that a widely held aversion to political control of the economy is just one element that could stand in the way of this new thinking on the military-industrial complex. New York Times, well, I read it in the International Herald Tribune of 18 October. But it's probably a day later because the Herald Tribune picks up the New York Times with about a day's delay. But I thought that faced with Gorbachev's new thinking, that the Pentagon new thinking gave something to think about. So anyway, now we'll be taking questions. Please.
I appreciated hearing from the three gentlemen. It was very impressive. But Diana Johnstone, I'd love to hear from you. I did come to hear from you. And a suggestion would be that perhaps would it be too impromptu to apply Professor Singham's thoughts to Europe? you can do it.
Well, I'm really not prepared. I was thinking about that as I was listening to Professor Singham, because there is a regional crisis developing. There is a crisis of competition between regions, and it's being stated in the way precisely of economic war between the regions. And it's very dangerous to see what kind of regional division is developing, because there is a great deal of talk about the European common market finally becoming a common market, although wait a little bit. But there's a huge campaign that is going on, especially in the financial press, the Wall Street Journal, and so on, against Fortress Europe. You know, they're going to cheat, as usual. They're going to cheat and practice protectionism so that we can't take over everything there. And they're going to protect their farmers. They're not going to drive them off all the land so that we can, you know, flood the place with our soybeans and hamburgers. And in fact, this amounts to an enormous attack on the European welfare state, which of course allows people to live in Europe much better than they live in this country. And I don't know what form this is going to take, because the idea is to break down all the economic barriers so that American multinationals can take over and banking and so on, so that you'll have the same kind of economic system in Europe with people out on the streets and homeless and so on. But there's going to be resistance to this, and it's very difficult. It seems to me that there has to be some kind of protectionism of standards of living. There has to be some protectionism somewhere of other value systems that you mentioned, of another objective in life than a national security state whose function is to protect the security of the national security state, as we just heard from this recommendations to the Pentagon, that the economy is to serve the national security state. It started out that we started out with military Keynesianism, which was the American version of what in fact was the national socialist, the Nazi solution to the Depression. Because the reason that the National Socialist, Hitler's party, got into power is it was the only party in Germany that had an answer to the Depression, which hit Germany, remember, harder than anywhere, any place, because of the Versailles Accords and so on. You had the worst unemployment. You had also a very strong left. So the industrialists backed the Nazi party because it was the only one that was willing to practice deficit spending in order to build up a national security state. And that is the pattern, that is the only pattern that solved the Depression from the capitalist point of view. It was adopted by the United States since, and that is the model we have today. And of course, it is becoming more and more of a monster that's eating up the economy, that is destroying the environment, that is destroying all kinds of social conditions, and there will be regional resistance, and Europe is one place of this, although it's very hard to get together because Europeans are very diverse from each other, and the problems of getting any of them to get together on anything is what allows the United States to come in and dominate, because it has a simple culture, it has Disneyland, which is going to, you know, come in and make everybody into Disneyland consumers. And so this is, it is also, I think, very, very much a cultural battle. Well, that's all I can say, just spontaneously like that.
Mr. Ellsberg has warned us that during World War II, the presence of an absolute enemy has given rise dialectically to the presence of an absolute means to defeat him. And yet, after defeating that enemy, that one absolute enemy, the absolute means to defeat him have somehow persisted and have continued to maintain dominance in this country. For 40 years or so, we've had the ability, and indeed held the world hostage with nuclear weapons, and it's some 25 years now, I think, that we've had the ability to destroy the world completely. The topic of discussion here, the national security state, is a little bit weaker than what Mr. Singham has gone on to say, the garrison state. I might as well ask you point blank now, having elected just within the past week an ex-CIA director as president, is the United States in fact today a military dictatorship?
Oh.
Who is your question to anybody in particular?
Perhaps Mr. Ellsberg, but in general to the panel.
I don't foresee any change whatever in the nature of the national. I don't foresee any change whatever in the nature of the national security state that we've been living under. It would be an illusion, a romantic notion of what we've been living under, to think that to openly make Mr. Bush the president is some fundamental change in the way this country is governed, any more than it was a fundamental change when a Republican campaign manager was made director of the CIA, that is Bush, and by the way, Casey later, that little tradition. So I like your way of putting it, by the way. I think the word dialectical is particularly apt in this case, a process in which there was a real convergence in interaction and in transformation of all parties and of the whole system. And if I may say, I was listening to Diana, realizing that what she was saying really was, in part, that we became like what we fought, not only in the point that I made, the uses of total war, but in the peacetime uses of military Keynesianism. Mm-hmm. We should also recall, what's often not recalled, by the way, that the defining characteristic, probably, of Nazism was anti-communism, at least as much as anti-Semitism, In fact, interviews of SS officers now, and conceivably retrospective, but not apparently so, I haven't been studying this subject, reveals that they see themselves as having been above all crusaders against Bolshevism, that the Jews were carriers of Bolshevism, as a matter of fact, and that in effect the Nazis were premature anti-Bolsheviks, and that's anti-communists, and that's the way they see themselves. So this anti-communism virus, which of course has always been present in our culture in an anti-socialist, anti-radical, almost, it is almost the American religion, civic religion, but I think what I was saying and what Diana was saying and really all of us has been that it did take a new meaning with World War II when certain characteristics of Nazism were grafted on to our image of communism, and then we became like what we held to a considerable extent. That's where we are. Let me answer very finally in a way that I hadn't mentioned. I was just looking through some notes and I noticed that I gave my wife, Patricia Ellsberg, some of you know, Ed Herman's book, The Real Terror Network, about the activities not just of the CIA but ultimately of the IMF, an institution we dominate in the world economic system, the banks and other things in Latin America and Central America, and the effect of that on quite specifically the methods of terrorism and death squads in Latin America, a quite stunning book which I recommend to all of you. And she woke up the next morning, I remember next to me crying and saying, we are like the Nazis. We are acting like the Nazis. And I said to her, to my wife, I'm known for 24 years now, I said, you know, that's a secret that I've been holding to my heart for a long time, since I was in the Pentagon. I was 14 when the war ended, and I really didn't want to join an organization that was like the Nazis. And that's what I did join by mistake. And that didn't start with George Bush, and it's going to take more than one administration to end it, but that is our task.
Following up on the death squad work, and especially in El Salvador, in our labor panel yesterday, we were talking about some of the more gruesome outrages against labor, which is, of course, one of the first to go. I was curious, in both Dr. Singham and Dr. Falk. Dr. Singham mentioned the demobilization, absolutely correct, of the anti-war, the black movement in advancing the national security state. It was interesting that you ignored, perhaps because of time, the equally profound demobilization, often bloody, of the workers' struggle against capital. Similarly, Dr. Falk, you focused, unless I misheard, and also time constraints, the intensity of anti-communism as that cohering ideology in and around the post-World War II, when in fact, that kind of attack anti-communism began when we first learned of Marx, and again, bloody attacks on workers, and I think that should be brought into our historic reference, if you would comment. Last, I wondered if both the two of you, certainly Dr. Ellsberg, would advance for us, at least in outline form for back home analysis and organizing, your projection of this new radicalism that Dr. Falk mentioned, which we really have to use and structure to repudiate our bankrupt institutions or our nationally security state-oriented institutions and parties. Similarly, Dr. Singham mentioned alternatives to the garrison state. So if you could project that or develop that a little further.
Let me first say that I think that one of the reasons that anti-communism was so successful as a cohering ideology was that it did have these antecedents that went back to the response to the Russian Revolution, to the fear that capitalism has always felt in relation to an ideology that questions the whole ethos of private property at the expense of social justice. And so I think such an ideology had enormous resonance within our political culture. And I think it's a mistake not to understand that there is in the political culture a permission to have the national security state. It's a mistake to scapegoat just the leadership. It is more the leadership has been influenced, it seems to me, by a tradition of accepting violence against those who are identified as illegitimate, as outside the protected circle, outside the fortress, to use Archie's language, going back to the treatment of the Indians. There has always been that permission given. And one of the scary things about Bush's selection and the CIA credential that he brings to this high office is that it's so acceptable. See, that it doesn't bother anyone, that we have become so routinized that we willingly go to the polls having this privilege to select our leaders that other people fight and die to have, and yet we don't protect it. We don't make it mean anything for us if we select someone who's been the head of a murderous secret police force voluntarily, and don't even discuss it. It's, again, outside the boundaries of what can be responsibly discussed. If anything, it makes him, gives him his claim to be experienced. See, that's his experience. It's the experience of crime as the credential for the presidency. That's not encouraging.
Just because I see the lines are long, I'm just to be very quick in terms of response to the option. I really think one of the greatest dangers we have today is this problem of the national security state becoming the leaders in the doctrine of the privatization of public institutions. This very dangerous assault on public education, assault on all public activities, the gains that people have went to strike for, that you talked about, in terms of the labor movement, to create at least a modicum of decency in terms of daily livelihood, in terms of housing, public housing, etc. Now this assault on the public sector and calling for the privatization of this sector simply means unleashing, if you wish, a new political ethic that says privatization means everything for everybody and the reduction of social responsibility and the notion of civic society and civic obligations. So what this is an attack on the theory of democracy as a, and democratic society as a civic society. So what I think we have to organize now is to organize people to protect public institutions and the rights that people struggle for, to create places like Brooklyn College and not result in the privatization of such a phenomenon.
Mr. Ellsberg, I'd like to address this to you. You said there was a change in ethic in the 1940s during World War II, with the US military deciding that it would now use civilians as targets. Okay, why would you not think that this was not in operation, say, back in the late 20s, when the United States Air Force was deliberately bombing peasant villages in Nicaragua to kill off the civilian communities in northern Nicaragua who were perhaps provisioning, supporting the Sandino? Perhaps you could address, isn't it kind of misleading to think that it was in the 1940s we changed this and not back in the late 20s?
A very simple distinction answers that, as a matter of fact. And it was made by M.A. Césaire, actually, in his comment, in his interpretation of why the European world was so bothered by Hitler. What he pointed out from his perspective was that Hitler was using against white Europeans, both Jewish and non-Jewish, the techniques that all these powers had routinely and without question used against colonial peoples for a century. Generation, that the techniques of massacre, torture, and internment were really quite routine. And as bombing planes became available, they were routinely used against colonial peoples, in which Nicaragua effectively countered. And I've been in a place in Nicaragua, actually, that experienced that possibly first bombing raid against civilian populations. Your history is very good there. But it could be joined by the fact that when Germany and others proposed that in the disarmament conferences that were taking place in the late 20s, that bombing planes be forbidden, above all because of their potential for use against civilian populations, Britain, represented by Anthony Eden at the conference, blocked that agreement, which, by the way, had a quite wide measure of global agreement at that time, on the grounds that Britain absolutely needed those planes to use against, quote, native tribesmen in the region of Afghanistan, northern India, and Yemen at that time. And that acceptance against colonial people, once Hitler had shown the way that methods that were good against colonial people could perhaps be used against their neighbors, Eden reaped that whirlwind, as a matter of fact, and we have gone on from there. So,
yes, for the whole panel, please. What are the most hopeful challenges and constraints on the internationalization of the national security state or the garrison state from Europe, from, say, the Caribbean, and from within the United States? And I hope we could say more, well, everybody keep doing more of what we're doing, but what are the most effective and concentrated and popular challenges that we can mount to the national security state? And should it be in terms of challenging the culture of militarism or more on quality of life questions? I mean, obviously there's an economic question here, because the more we spend on military, the less on social services, say, or on the welfare state. Should the challenge be in terms of this quality of life question, or in terms of the civic democracy or culture of militarism side? Obviously the answer is going to be some of both, and everybody should do more of what we're doing, but I wonder if we can concentrate a little bit and say, what should we do next?
I think it's a difficult time to be very clear about what priorities should be, and it may be that it's not necessary to have a single view about what's most important and what's most effective. One may need to explore a variety of initiatives based on a variety of analyses as to what is most indispensable, and that the most important understanding is the desperate, urgent need to found a political alternative vision that can give people hope that they can address the real problems and the real challenges facing American society. And I think they overlap these areas, that it does, we are challenged to find ways to recover popular sovereignty. Because without the recovery of popular sovereignty, without being able to control the government, without being able to make it accountable, nothing else is possible. So that the first thing is to stop acting like subjects and begin acting like citizens. And to make people feel that. The only other thing that I would say is that I do think that letting people understand that the Gorbachev opening toward a more peaceful, more stable world may not last forever. That it is a historic opportunity that is indispensably related to the possibilities of really ending the nuclear arms race, of creating a world without nuclear weapons, and that's an extraordinary challenge to fail to respond to. And that if we have any kind of sense of our own responsibility to future generations, we must respond to this challenge at this time.
Well, obviously, when you have something that covers every aspect of life, there has to be a response on every level. all cultural levels. My suggestion would be, of course, to get rid of, usually to get rid of one threat, you need another. I mean, to say there, it used to be there was the religious wars, and then that wore out, and then you have another threat. Now it's the communist threat. Well, luckily, there's another threat to overcome the socialist, the Soviet threat, or whatever it is, and that's the environmental threat. This is a threat that for is the first time you have a threat that can unite everybody instead of dividing somebody against somebody else. You have the ozone hole. You have the greenhouse effect. I think it's beginning to become clear that the real threat to our survival is ourselves. And that the latest Pugwash conference, for instance, came out with this conclusion. The Pugwash conference of scientists who have been meeting for a very long time, Soviet American and international, on the dangers of nuclear war. And I was saying, well, the dangers of war are now equaled by the dangers of the destruction of the environment. And I think this is the area where we can really get together, where there are no adversaries, where we are all together for the survival of life on the planet.
Let me follow up on the points raised here on both. As I said earlier, I think no problem we face can be faced without a widespread international collaboration, and very much so between the U.S. and the Soviet Union, which is certainly being proposed by Gorbachev now. To add to the points on the environment that have just been made and some of the others, nothing that either leader in the Soviet Union or either candidate in this recent election proposed as an aim is remotely capable of being achieved with the current level of defense expenditure in either of those societies. Moreover, by the way, it's politically, I think, implausible that either will make great reductions without the other, either reductions in specific weapons or in the most dangerous kinds, such as the Trident II, or of the overall level. Without mutual reductions, I think, to take a degree of tacit or open collaboration, neither will achieve it. But I come back to the point, to take it to the Soviet Union, for example, which is very well recognized over there. Nothing that Gorbachev is proposing can be achieved, and we will lose him as a proponent of global collaboration unless he manages to reduce his defense budget. Without that, what he has is voodoo perestroika. And they are very aware of that, but they are also, and they're going to do a lot unilaterally, I believe, but he's limited in how far he could go. That's why we needed a candidate who would respond to his proposals for these mutual cuts. Dukakis always looked to me more likely to that, though who can say, because as you may have noticed, he was not able to bring himself in his campaign to talk at all, either about collaboration or about reducing the defense budget, and I think to believe that that in office he would have shaken free of the constraints that that bound him during the campaign was not to count on very much. So it does depend on us. I do want to mention the one other thing then that affects our globe, our culture, that constrains these people. Another aspect that we needed for this global buildup that we've had, or the U.S. buildup in the Cold War, was the militarism that we've been hearing about from Archie. I totally agree with all that. I want to mention one aspect of that that hasn't been mentioned enough, I think. The militarism was necessary for the buildup, and what underlies the militarism is what has always underlied militarism for thousands of years, and that is male domination. That is an ethic of machismo. The demonstration of the general principle of hierarchy and separation and enemyhood in the form of so-called male values, warlike values, and male domination. I recommend, by the way, to all of you who don't know it, Rian Eisler's book, The Chalice and the Blade, if you want to know how far back this goes, and also its religious roots. That suggests something that can be done right now. If we're to do what my friend Michael Clare once said years ago, as he defined our problem, to combat or to transcend the hegemony, the cultural hegemony of militarism, that's a target that is all around, and wherever we are, we can struggle usefully against it. And in terms of this one specific point I'm making, I think that the point that has been on the struggle that's being waged in the churches right now to combat in the Catholic Church, in the Episcopal Church, and a number of other churches, those aspects of those religions that have defined them as religions of male domination for 2,000 years are very hopeful signs on the one hand and need to be backed very much. A little more broadly, Reagan's whole scheme for 8 years, now epitomized by the Bush campaign, concentrated and focused, is the inculcation of machismo, the standing tall, the so-called male values. That has to be challenged now much more than it has been. As I say, Bush raised it to the point of absurdity in this particular campaign, and won with it. We really can't go on with a man being able to win with that campaign.
I just noticed a little news item. Sorry. Okay. Is that all right? Okay. We're getting ready for questions. I have a news item here from the New York Times last month that a report to Defense Secretary Frank Colucci by a study group of the Defense Science Board, quote, an influential advisory group whose members come from industry and academia, which has urged the Pentagon to assert influence over economic policy. This is news. To head off, quote, an increasing loss of technological leadership to both allies and adversaries. And this is the latest in a series of reviews by the military-industrial complex conducted this year by things like the Congressional Office of Technology Assessment, the Air Force Association, the National Defense University, and so on, that are all urging the Pentagon to exert more influence over taxes, trade laws, environmental regulation, and education in order to protect the military-industrial complex. And the New York Times reporter says that a widely held aversion to political control of the economy is just one element that could stand in the way of this new thinking on the military-industrial complex. New York Times, well, I read it in the International Herald Tribune of 18 October. But it's probably a day later because the Herald Tribune picks up the New York Times with about a day's delay. But I thought that faced with Gorbachev's new thinking, that the Pentagon new thinking gave something to think about. So anyway, now we'll be taking questions. Please.
I appreciated hearing from the three gentlemen. It was very impressive, but Diana Johnstone, I'd love to hear from you. I did come to hear from you. And a suggestion would be that perhaps would it be too impromptu to apply Professor Singham's thoughts to Europe? you can do it.
Well, I'm really not prepared, but certainly there. Yes, I was thinking about that as I was listening to Professor Singham, because there is a regional crisis developing. There is a crisis of competition between regions, and it's being stated in the way precisely of economic war between the regions, and it's very dangerous to see what kind of regional division is developing, because there is a great deal of talk about the European common market finally becoming a common market, although wait a little bit. But there's a huge campaign that is going on, especially in the financial press, the Wall Street Journal, and so on, against Fortress Europe. You know, they're going to cheat, as usual. They're going to cheat and practice protectionism so that we can't take over everything there. and they're going to protect our farmers. They're not going to drive them off all the land so that we can, you know, flood the place with our soybeans and hamburgers. And in fact, this amounts to an enormous attack on the European welfare state, which of course allows people to live in Europe much better than they live in this country. And I don't know what form this is going to take, because the idea is to, of course, to break down all the economic barriers so that American multinationals can take over and banking and so on, so that you'll have the same kind of economic system in Europe with people out on the streets and homeless and so on. But and there's going to be resistance to this, and it's very difficult. It seems to me that the there has to be some kind of protectionism of standards of living. There has to be some protectionism somewhere of other value systems that you mentioned, of another objective in life than a national security state whose function is to protect the security of the national security state, as we just heard from this recommendations to the Pentagon, that the economy is to serve the national security state. It started out that we started out with military Keynesianism, which was the American version of what in fact was the national socialist, the Nazi solution to the Depression, because the reason that National Socialist, Hitler's party, got into power is it was the only party in Germany that had an answer to the Depression, which hit Germany, remember, harder than anywhere, any place, because of the Versailles Accords and so on. You had the worst, unemployment. You had also a very strong left. So the industrialists backed the Nazi party because it was the only one that was willing to practice deficit spending in order to build up a national security state. And that is the pattern, that is the only pattern that solved the Depression from the capitalist point of view. It was adopted by the United States since, and that is the model we have today. And of course, it is becoming more and more of a monster that's eating up the economy, that is destroying the environment, that is making, that is destroying all kinds of social conditions, and there will be regional resistance, and Europe is one place of this, although it's very hard to get together because Europeans are very diverse from each other, and the problems of getting any of them to get together on anything is what allows the United States to come in and dominate, because it has a simple culture, it has Disneyland, which is going to, you know, come in and make everybody into Disneyland consumers. And so this is, it is also, I think, very, very much a cultural battle. Well, that's all I can say, just spontaneously like that.
Mr. Ellsberg has warned us that during World War II, the presence of an absolute enemy has given rise dialectically to the presence of an absolute means to defeat him. And yet, after defeating that enemy, that one absolute enemy, the absolute means to defeat him have somehow persisted and have continued to maintain dominance in this country. For 40 years or so, we've had the ability, and indeed held the world hostage with nuclear weapons, and it's some 25 years now, I think, that we've had the ability to destroy the world completely. The topic of discussion here, the national security state, is a little bit weaker than what Mr. Singham has gone on to say, the garrison state. I might as well ask you point blank now, having elected just within the past week an ex-CIA director as president, is the United States in fact today a military dictatorship?
Oh. Who is your question to anybody in particular?
Perhaps Mr. Ellsberg, but in general to the panel.
Do you want Ben? Ben, do you want
to? I don't foresee any change whatever in the nature of the national. I don't foresee any change whatever in the nature of the national security state that we've been living under. It would be an illusion, a romantic notion of what we've been living under, to think that to openly make Mr. Bush the president is some fundamental change in the way this country is governed, any more than it was a fundamental change when a Republican campaign manager was made director of the CIA, that is Bush, and by the way, Casey later, that little tradition. So I like your way of putting it, by the way. I think the word dialectical is particularly apt in this case, a process in which there was a real convergence in interaction and in transformation of all parties and of the whole system. And if I may say, I was listening to Diana, realizing that what she was saying really was, in part, that we became like what we fought, not only in the point that I made, the uses of total war, but in the peacetime uses of military Keynesianism. Mm-hmm. We should also recall, what's often not recalled, by the way, that the defining characteristic, probably, of Nazism was anti-communism, at least as much as anti-Semitism. In fact, interviews of SS officers now, and retrospective, but not apparently so, I happen to be studying this subject, reveals that they see themselves as having been above all crusaders against Bolshevism, that the Jews were carriers of Bolshevism, as a matter of fact, and that, in effect, the Nazis were premature anti-Bolsheviks, and that's anti-communists, and that's the way they see themselves. So this anti-communism virus, which of course has always been present in our culture in an anti-socialist, anti-radical, it is almost the American religion, civic religion. But I think what I was saying and what Diana was saying and really all of us has been that it did take a new meaning with World War II when certain characteristics of Nazism were grafted on to our image of communism, and then we became like what we held to a considerable extent. That's where we are. Let me answer very finally in a way that I hadn't mentioned. I was just looking through some notes, and I noticed that I gave my wife, Patricia Ellsberg, some of you know, Ed Herman's book, The Real Terror Network, about the activities not just of the CIA, but ultimately of the IMF, an institution we dominate in the world economic system, the banks and other things, in Latin America and Central America, and the effect of that on, quite specifically, the methods of terrorism and death squads in Latin America. A quite stunning book, which I recommend to all of you. And she woke up the next morning, I remember next to me, crying and saying, "We are like the Nazis. We are acting like the Nazis." And I said to her, to my wife, I'm known for 24 years now, I said, "You know, that's a secret that I've been holding to my heart for a long time, since I was in the Pentagon. I was 14 when the war ended, and I really didn't want to join an organization that was like the Nazis. And that's what I did join by mistake. And that didn't start with George Bush, and it's going to take more than one administration to end it, but that is our task."
Following up on the death squad work, and especially in El Salvador, in our labor panel yesterday, we were talking about some of the more gruesome outrages against labor, which is, of course, one of the first to go. I was curious, in both Dr. Singham and Dr. Falk, Dr. Singham mentioned the demobilization, absolutely correct, of the anti-war, the black movement in advancing the national security state. It was interesting that you ignored, perhaps because of time, the equally profound demobilization, often bloodied, of the workers' struggle against capital. Similarly, Dr. Falk, you focused, unless I misheard, and also time constraints, the intensity of anti-communism as that cohering ideology in and around the post-World War II, when in fact, that kind of attack anti-communism began when we first learned of Marx, and again, bloody attacks on workers, and I think that should be brought into our historic reference, if you would comment. Last, I wondered if both the two of you, certainly Dr. Ellsberg, would advance for us, at least in outline form for back-home analysis and organizing, your projection of this new radicalism that Dr. Falk mentioned, which we really have to use and structure to repudiate our bankrupt institutions or our nationally security state-oriented institutions and parties. Similarly, Dr. Singham mentioned alternatives to the garrison state. So if you could project that or develop that a little further.
let me first say that I think that one of the reasons that anti-communism was so successful as a cohering ideology was that it did have these antecedents that went back to the response to the Russian Revolution, to the fear that capitalism has always felt in relation to an ideology that questions the whole ethos of private property at the expense of social justice. And so I think such an ideology had enormous resonance within our political culture. And I think it's a mistake not to understand that there is in the political culture a permission to have the national security state. It's a mistake to scapegoat just the leadership. The leadership has been influenced, it seems to me, by a tradition of accepting violence against those who are identified as illegitimate, as outside the protected circle, outside the fortress, to use Archie's language, going back to the treatment of the Indians. There has always been that permission given. And one of the scary things about Bush's selection and the CIA credential that he brings to this high office is that it's so acceptable. See, that it doesn't bother anyone, that we have become so routinized that we willingly go to the polls having this privilege to select our leaders that other people fight and die to have, and yet we don't protect it. We don't make it mean anything for us if we select someone who's been the head of a murderous secret police force voluntarily, and don't even discuss it. It's, again, outside the boundaries of what can be responsibly discussed. If anything, it gives him his claim to be experienced. See, that's his experience. It's the experience of crime as the credential for the presidency. That's not encouraging.
Just because I see the lines along, I'm just to be very quick in terms of response to the option. I really think one of the greatest dangers we have today is this problem of the national security state becoming the leaders in the doctrine of the privatization of public institutions. This very dangerous assault on public education, assault on all public activities, the gains that people have went to strike for that you talked about in terms of the labor movement to create at least a modicum of decency in terms of daily livelihood, in terms of housing, public housing, etc. Now this assault on the public sector and calling for the privatization of this sector simply means unleashing, if you wish, a new political ethic that says privatization means everything for everybody and the reduction of social responsibility and the notion of civic society and civic obligations. So what this is an attack on the theory of democracy as and democratic society as a civic society. So what I think we have to organize now is to organize people to protect public institutions and the rights that people struggle for to create places like Brooklyn College and not result in the privatization of such a phenomenon.
Mr. Ellsberg, I'd like to address this to you. You said there was a change in ethic in the 1940s during World War II with the U.S. military deciding that it would now use civilians as targets. Okay, why would you not think that this was not in operation, say, back in the late 20s, when the United States Air Force was deliberately bombing peasant villages in Nicaragua to kill off the civilian communities in northern Nicaragua who were perhaps provisioning, supporting the Sandino perhaps you could address, isn't it kind of misleading to think that it was the 1940s we changed this and not back in the late 20s?
A very simple distinction answers that, as a matter of fact. And it was made by Aimé Césaire, actually, in his comment, in his interpretation of why the European world was so bothered by Hitler. What he pointed out from his perspective was that Hitler was using against white Europeans, both Jewish and non-Jewish, the techniques that all these powers had routinely and without question used against colonial peoples for a century, generation, that the techniques of massacre, torture, and internment were really quite routine. And as bombing planes became available, they were routinely used against colonial peoples, in which Nicaragua effectively countered. And I've been in a place in Nicaragua, actually, that experienced that possibly first bombing raid against civilian populations. Your history is very good there. But it could be joined by the fact that when Germany and others proposed that in the disarmament conferences that were taking place in the late 20s, that bombing planes be forbidden, above all because of their potential for use against civilian populations, Britain, represented by Anthony Eden at the conference, blocked that agreement, which, by the way, had a quite wide measure of global agreement at that time, on the grounds that Britain absolutely needed those planes to use against, quote, native tribesmen in the region of Afghanistan, northern India, and Yemen at that time. And that acceptance against colonial people, once Hitler had shown the way that methods that were good against colonial people could perhaps be used against their neighbors, Eden reaped that whirlwind, as a matter of fact, and we have gone on from there. So,
yes, for the whole panel, please. What are the most hopeful challenges and constraints on the internationalization of the national security state or the garrison state from Europe, from, say, the Caribbean, and from within the United States? And I hope we could say more that, well, everybody keep doing more of what we're doing, but what are the most effective and concentrated and popular challenges that we can mount to the national security state? And should it be in terms of challenging the culture of militarism or more on quality of life questions? I mean, obviously there's an economic question here, because the more we spend on military, the less on social services, say, or on the welfare state. Should the challenge be in terms of this quality of life question, or in terms of the civic democracy or culture of militarism side? Obviously the answer is going to be some of both, you know, and everybody should do more of what we're doing, but I wonder if we can concentrate a little bit and say, what should we do next?
I think it's a difficult time to be very clear about what priorities should be, and it may be that it's not necessary to have a single view about what's most important and what's most effective. One may need to explore a variety of initiatives based on a variety of analyses as to what is most indispensable, and that the most important understanding is the desperate, urgent need to found a political alternative vision that can give people hope that they can address the real problems and the real challenges facing American society. And I think they overlap these areas, that it does, we are challenged to find ways to recover popular sovereignty. Because without the recovery of popular sovereignty, without being able to control the government, without being able to make it accountable, nothing else is possible. So that the first thing is to stop acting like subjects and begin acting like citizens. And to make people feel that. The only other thing that I would say is that I do think that letting people understand that the Gorbachev opening toward a more peaceful, more stable world may not last forever. That it is a historic opportunity that is indispensably related to the possibilities of really ending the nuclear arms race, of creating a world without nuclear weapons, and that that's an extraordinary challenge to fail to respond to. And that if we have any kind of sense of our own responsibility to future generations, we must respond to this challenge at this time.
Well, obviously, when you have something that covers every aspect of life, there has to be a response on every level, all cultural levels. My suggestion would be, of course, to get rid of one threat, you need another. I mean, to say there was the religious wars, and then that wore out, and then you have another threat. Now it's the communist threat. Well, luckily, there's another threat to overcome the socialist, the Soviet threat, or whatever it is, and that's the environmental threat. This is a threat that is the first time you have a threat that can unite everybody instead of dividing somebody against somebody else. You have the ozone hole. You have the greenhouse effect. I think it's beginning to become clear that the real threat to our survival is ourselves. And that the latest Pugwash conference, for instance, came out with this conclusion. The Pugwash conference of scientists who have been meeting for a very long time, Soviet American and international, on the dangers of nuclear war. And I was saying, well, the dangers of war are now equaled by the dangers of the destruction of the environment. And I think this is the area where we can really get together, where there are no adversaries, where we are all together for the survival of life on the planet.
Let me follow up on the points raised here on both. As I said earlier, I think no problem we face can be faced without a widespread international collaboration, and very much so between the U.S. and the Soviet Union, which is certainly being proposed by Gorbachev now. To add to the points on the environment that have just been made and some of the others, nothing that either leader in the Soviet Union or either candidate in this recent election proposed as an aim is remotely capable of being achieved with the current level of defense expenditure in either of those societies. Moreover, by the way, it's politically, I think, implausible that either will make great reductions without the other. Either reductions in specific weapons or in the most dangerous kinds, such as the Trident II, or of the overall level. Without mutual reductions, I think, to take a degree of tacit or open collaboration, neither will achieve it. But I come back to the point, to take it to the Soviet Union, for example, which is very well recognized over there. Nothing that Gorbachev is proposing can be achieved, and we will lose him as a proponent of global collaboration, unless he manages to reduce his defense budget. Without that, what he has is voodoo perestroika. And they are very aware of that. But they are also, and they're going to do a lot unilaterally, I believe, but he's limited in how far he could go. That's why we needed a candidate who would respond to his proposals for these mutual cuts. Dukakis always looked to me more likely to that, though who can say, because as you may have noticed, he was not able to bring himself in his campaign to talk at all, either about collaboration or about reducing the defense budget, and I think to believe that that in office he would have shaken free of the constraints that that bound him during the campaign was not to count on very much. So it does depend on us. I do want to mention the one other thing then that affects our globe, our culture, that constrains these people. Another aspect that we needed for this global buildup that we've had, or the US buildup in the Cold War, was the militarism that we've been hearing about from Archie. I totally agree with all that. I want to mention one aspect of that that hasn't been mentioned enough, I think. The militarism was necessary for the buildup, and what underlies the militarism is what has always underlied militarism for thousands of years, and that is male domination. That is an ethic of machismo. the demonstration of the general principle of hierarchy and separation and enemyhood in the form of so-called male values, warlike values, and male domination. I recommend, by the way, to all of you who don't know it, Rian Eisler's book, The Chalice and the Blade, if you want to know how far back this goes, and also its religious roots. That suggests something that can be done right now. If we're to do what my friend Michael Clare once said years ago, as he defined our problem, to combat or to transcend the hegemony, the cultural hegemony of militarism, that's a target that is all around, and wherever we are, we can struggle usefully against it. And in terms of this one specific point I'm making, I think that the point that has been on the struggle that's being waged in the churches right now to combat in the Catholic Church, in the Episcopal Church, and a number of other churches, those aspects of those religions that have defined them as religions of male domination for 2,000 years are very hopeful signs on the one hand and need to be backed very much. A little more broadly, Reagan's whole scheme for 8 years, now epitomized by the Bush campaign, concentrated and focused, is the inculcation of machismo, the standing tall, the so-called male values. That has to be challenged now much more than it has been. As I say, Bush raised it to the point of absurdity in this particular campaign and won with it. We really can't go on with a man being able to win with that campaign.
I just noticed a little news item. Sorry. Okay. Is that all right? Okay. We're getting ready for questions. I have a news item here from the New York Times last month that there a report to Defense Secretary Frank Colucci by a study group of the Defense Science Board, quote, an influential advisory group whose members come from industry and academia, which has urged the Pentagon to assert influence over economic policy. This is news. To head off, quote, an increasing loss of technological leadership to both allies and adversaries. And this is the latest in a series of reviews by the military-industrial complex conducted this year by things like the Congressional Office of Technology Assessment, the Air Force Association, the National Defense University, and so on, that are all urging the Pentagon to exert more influence over taxes, trade laws, environmental regulation, and education in order to protect the military-industrial complex. And the New York Times reporter says that a widely held aversion to political control of the economy is just one element that could stand in the way of this new thinking on the military-industrial complex. New York Times, well, I read it in the International Herald Tribune of 18 October. But it's probably a day later because the Herald Tribune picks up the New York Times with about a day's delay. But I thought that faced with Gorbachev's new thinking, that the Pentagon new thinking gave something to think about. So anyway, now we'll be taking questions. Please.
I appreciated hearing from the three gentlemen. It was very impressive, but Diana Johnstone, I'd love to hear from you. I did come to hear from you. And a suggestion would be that perhaps would it be too impromptu to apply Professor Singham's thoughts to Europe? You can do it.
Well, I'm really not prepared, but I certainly I was thinking about that as I was listening to Professor Singham, because there is a regional crisis developing. There is a crisis of competition between regions, and it's being stated in the way precisely of economic war between the regions. And it's very dangerous to see what kind of regional division is developing, because there is a great deal of talk about the European common market finally becoming a common market, although wait a little bit. But there's a huge campaign that is going on, especially in the financial press, the Wall Street Journal, and so on, against Fortress Europe. You know, they're going to cheat, as usual. They're going to cheat and practice protectionism so that we can't take over everything there. And they're going to protect their farmers. They're not going to drive them off all the land so that we can, you know, flood the place with our soybeans and hamburgers. And in fact, this amounts to an enormous attack on the European welfare state, which of course allows people to live in Europe much better than they live in this country. And I don't know what form this is going to take, because the idea is to, of course, to break down all the economic barriers so that American multinationals can take over and banking and so on, so that you'll have the same kind of economic system in Europe with people on the streets and homeless and so on. And there's going to be resistance to this, and it's very difficult. It seems to me that there has to be some kind of protectionism of standards of living. There has to be some protectionism somewhere of other value systems that you mentioned, of another objective in life than a national security state, whose function is to protect the security of the national security state, as we just heard from this recommendations to the Pentagon, that the economy is to serve the national security state. It started out we started out with military Keynesianism, which was the American version of what in fact was the national socialist, the Nazi solution to the Depression, because the reason that the National Socialist, Hitler's party, got into power is it was the only party in Germany that had an answer to the Depression, which hit Germany, remember, harder than anywhere, any place, because of the Versailles Accords and so on. You had the worst unemployment. You had also a very strong left. So the industrialists backed the Nazi party because it was the only one that was willing to practice deficit spending in order to build up a national security state. And that is the pattern, that is the only pattern that solved the Depression from the capitalist point of view. It was adopted by the United States since, and that is the model we have today. And of course, it is becoming more and more of a monster that's eating up the economy, that is destroying the environment, that is destroying all kinds of social conditions, and there will be regional resistance, and Europe is one place of this, although it's very hard to get together because Europeans are very diverse from each other, and the problems of getting any of them to get together on anything is what allows the United States to come in and dominate, because it has a simple culture, it has Disneyland, which is going to, you know, come in and make everybody into Disneyland consumers. And so it is also, I think, very, very much a cultural battle. Well, that's all I can say, just spontaneously like that.
Mr. Ellsberg has warned us that during World War II, the presence of an absolute enemy has given rise dialectically to the presence of an absolute means to defeat him. And yet, after defeating that enemy, that one absolute enemy, the absolute means to defeat him have somehow persisted and have continued to maintain dominance in this country. For 40 years or so, we've had the ability, and indeed have held the world hostage with nuclear weapons, and it's some 25 years now, I think, that we've had the ability to destroy the world completely. The topic of discussion here, the national security state, is a little bit weaker than what Mr. Singham has gone on to say, the garrison state. I might as well ask you point blank now, having elected just within the past week an ex-CIA director as president, is the United States in fact today a military dictatorship?
Oh.
Is your question to anybody in particular?
Perhaps Mr. Ellsberg, but in general to the panel.
Do you want Daniel? Daniel, do you want
I don't foresee any change whatever in the nature of the national. I don't foresee any change whatever in the in the nature of the national security state that we've been living under. It would be an illusion, a romantic notion of what we've been living under, to think that to openly make Mr. Bush the president is some fundamental change in the way this country is governed, any more than it was a fundamental change when a Republican campaign manager was made director of the CIA, that is Bush, and by the way, Casey later, that little tradition. So I like your way of putting it, by the way. I think the word dialectical is particularly apt in this case, a process in which there was a real convergence in interaction and in transformation of all parties and of the whole system. And if I may say, I was listening to Diana, realizing that what she was saying really was, in part, that we became like what we fought, not only in the point that I made, the uses of total war, but in the peacetime uses of military Keynesianism. We should also recall, what's often not recalled, by the way, that the defining characteristic, probably, of Nazism was anti-communism, at least as much as anti-Semitism. In fact, interviews of SS officers now, and conceivably retrospective, but not apparently so, I happen to be studying this subject, reveals that they see themselves as having been above all crusaders against Bolshevism, that the Jews were carriers of Bolshevism, as a matter of fact, and that, in effect, the Nazis were premature anti-Bolsheviks, and that's anti-communists, and that's the way they see themselves. So this anti-communism virus, which of course has always been present in our culture in an anti-socialist, anti-radical, almost it is almost the American religion, civic religion, but I think what I was saying and what Diana was saying and really all of us has been that it did take a new meaning with World War II when certain characteristics of Nazism were grafted on to our image of communism, and then we became like what we held to a considerable extent. That's where we are. Let me answer very finally in a way that I hadn't mentioned. I was just looking through some notes and I noticed that I gave my wife, Patricia Ellsberg, some of you know, Ed Herman's book, The Real Terror Network, about the activities not just of the CIA, but ultimately of the IMF, an institution we dominate in the world economic system, the banks and other things in Latin America and Central America, and the effect of that on quite specifically the methods of terrorism and death squads in Latin America. A quite stunning book, which I recommend to all of you. And she woke up the next morning, I remember next to me crying and saying, "We are like the Nazis. We are acting like the Nazis." And I said to her, to my wife, I'm known for 24 years now, I said, "You know, that's a secret that I've been holding to my heart for a long time, since I was in the Pentagon. I was 14 when the war ended, and I really didn't want to join an organization that was like the Nazis. And that's what I did join by mistake. And that didn't start with George Bush, and it's going to take more than one administration to end it, but that is our task."
Following up on the death squad work, especially in El Salvador, in our labor panel yesterday, we were talking about some of the more gruesome outrages against labor, which is, of course, one of the first to go. I was curious, in both Dr. Singham and Dr. Falk, Dr. Singham mentioned the demobilization, absolutely correct, of the anti-war, and the black movement in advancing the national security state. It was interesting that you ignored, perhaps because of time, the equally profound demobilization, often bloody, of the workers' struggle against capital. Similarly, Dr. Falk, you focused, it's, unless I misheard, and also time constraints, the intensity of anti-communism as that cohering ideology in and around the post-World War II, when in fact, that kind of attack anti-communism began when we first learned of Marx, and again, bloody attacks on workers, and I think that should be brought into our historic reference, if you would comment. Last, I wondered if both the two of you, certainly Dr. Ellsberg, would advance for us, at least in outline form for back home analysis and organizing, your projection of this new radicalism that Dr. Falk mentioned, which we really have to use and structure to repudiate our bankrupt institutions or our nationally security state-oriented institutions and parties. Similarly, Dr. Singham mentioned alternatives to the garrison state. So if you could project that or develop that a little further.
Let me first say that I think that one of the reasons that anti-communism was so successful as a cohering ideology was that it did have these antecedents that went back to the response to the Russian Revolution, to the fear that capitalism has always felt in relation to an ideology that questions the whole ethos of private property at the expense of social justice. And so I think such an ideology had enormous resonance within our political culture. And I think it's a mistake not to understand that there is in the political culture a permission to have the national security state. It's a mistake to scapegoat just the leadership. The leadership has been influenced, it seems to me, by a tradition of accepting violence against those who are identified as illegitimate, as outside the protected circle, outside the fortress, to use Archie's language, going back to the treatment of the Indians. There has always been that permission given. And one of the scary things about Bush's selection and the CIA credential that he brings to this high office is that it's so acceptable. See, that it doesn't bother anyone, that we have become so routinized that we willingly go to the polls having this privilege to select our leaders that other people fight and die to have, and yet we don't protect it. We don't make it mean anything for us if we select someone who's been the head of a murderous secret police force voluntarily, and don't even discuss it. It's, again, outside the boundaries of what can be responsibly discussed. If anything, it gives him his claim to be experienced. See, that's his experience. It's the experience of crime as the credential for the presidency. That's not encouraging.
Just because I see the lines along, I'm just to be very quick in terms of the response to the option. I really think one of the greatest dangers we have today is this problem of the national security state becoming the leaders in the doctrine of the privatization of public institutions. This very dangerous assault on public education, assault on all public activities, the gains that people have went to strike for that you talked about in terms of the labor movement to create at least a modicum of decency in terms of daily livelihood, in terms of housing, public housing, etc. Now this assault on the public sector And calling for the privatization of this sector simply means unleashing, if you wish, a new political ethic that says privatization means everything for everybody and the reduction of social responsibility and the notion of civic society and civic obligations. So what this is an attack on the theory of democracy as a, and democratic society as a civic society. So what I think we have to organize now is to organize people to protect public institutions and the rights that people struggle for to create places like Brooklyn College and not result in the privatization of such an economy.
Mr. Ellsberg, I'd like to address this to you. You said there was a change in ethic in the 1940s during World War II with the U.S. military deciding that it would now use civilians as targets. Okay, why would you not think that this was not in operation, say, back in the late 20s when the United States Air Force was deliberately bombing peasant villages in Nicaragua to kill off the civilian communities in northern Nicaragua who were perhaps provisioning, supporting the Sandino? Perhaps you could address, isn't it kind of misleading to think that it was in the 1940s we changed this and not back in the late 20s?
A very simple distinction answers that, as a matter of fact. And it was made by Aimé Césaire, actually, in his comment, in his interpretation of why the European world was so bothered by Hitler. What he pointed out from his perspective was that Hitler was using against white Europeans, both Jewish and non-Jewish, the techniques that all these powers had routinely and without question used against colonial peoples for a century, generation, that the techniques of massacre, torture, and internment were really quite routine. And as bombing planes became available, they were routinely used against colonial peoples, in which Nicaragua effectively countered. And I've been in a place in Nicaragua, actually, that experienced that possibly first bombing raid against civilian populations. Your history is very good there. But it could be joined by the fact that when Germany and others proposed that in the disarmament conferences that were taking place in the late 20s, that bombing planes be forbidden, above all because of their potential for use against civilian populations, Britain, represented by Anthony Eden at the conference, blocked that agreement, which, by the way, had a quite wide measure of global agreement at that time, on the grounds that Britain absolutely needed those planes to use against, quote, native tribesmen in the region of Afghanistan, northern India, and Yemen at that time. And that acceptance against colonial people, once Hitler had shown the way that methods that were good against colonial people could perhaps be used against their neighbors, Eden reaped that whirlwind, as a matter of fact, and we have gone on from there. So,
yes, for the whole panel, please. What are the most hopeful challenges and constraints on the internationalization of the national security state or the garrison state from Europe, from, say, the Caribbean, and from within the United States? And I hope we could say more that, well, everybody keep doing more of what we're doing, but what are the most effective and concentrated and popular challenges that we can mount to the national security state? And should it be in terms of challenging the culture of militarism or more on quality of life questions? I mean, obviously there's an economic question here because the more we spend on military, the less on social services, say, or on the welfare state. Should the challenge be in terms of this quality of life question or in terms of the civic democracy or culture of militarism side? Obviously the answer is going to be some of both, and everybody should do more of what we're doing, but I wonder if we can concentrate a little bit and say, what should we do next?
I think it's a difficult time to be very clear about what priorities should be, and it may be that it's not necessary to have a single view about what's most important and what's most effective. One may need to explore a variety of initiatives based on a variety of analyses as to what is most indispensable, and that the most important understanding is the desperate, urgent need to found a political alternative vision that can give people hope that they can address the real problems and the real challenges facing American society. And I think they overlap these areas, that it does, we are challenged to find ways to recover popular sovereignty. Because without the recovery of popular sovereignty, without being able to control the government, without being able to make it accountable, nothing else is possible. So that the first thing is to stop acting like subjects and begin acting like citizens. And to make people feel that. The only other thing that I would say is that I do think that letting people understand that the Gorbachev opening toward a more peaceful, more stable world may not last forever. That it is a historic opportunity that is indispensably related to the possibilities of really ending the nuclear arms race, of creating a world without nuclear weapons, and that that's an extraordinary challenge to fail to respond to. And that if we have any kind of sense of our own responsibility to future generations, we must respond to this challenge at this time.
Well, obviously, when you have something that covers every aspect of life, there has to be a response on every level, all cultural levels. My suggestion would be, of course, to get rid of one threat, you need another. I mean, to say there was the religious wars, and then that wore out, and then you have another threat. Now it's the communist threat. Well, luckily, there's another threat to overcome the socialist, the Soviet threat, or whatever it is, and that's the environmental threat. This is a threat that is the first time you have a threat that can unite everybody instead of dividing somebody against somebody else. You have the ozone hole. You have the greenhouse effect. I think it's beginning to become clear that the real threat to our survival is ourselves. And that the latest Pugwash conference, for instance, came out with this conclusion. The Pugwash conference of scientists who have been meeting for a very long time, Soviet American and international, on the dangers of nuclear war. And I was saying, well, the dangers of war are now equaled by the dangers of the destruction of the environment. And I think this is the area where we can really get together, where there are no adversaries, where we are all together for the survival of life on the planet.
Let me follow up on the points raised here on both. As I said earlier, I think no problem we face can be faced without a widespread international collaboration, and very much so between the U.S. and the Soviet Union, which is certainly being proposed by Gorbachev now. To add to the points on the environment that have just been made and some of the others, nothing that either leader in the Soviet Union or either candidate in this recent election proposed as an aim is remotely capable of being achieved with the current level of defense expenditure in either of those societies. Moreover, by the way, it's politically, I think, implausible that either will make great reductions without the other, either reductions in specific weapons or in the most dangerous kinds, such as the Trident II, or of the overall level. Without mutual reductions, I think, to take a degree of tacit or open collaboration, neither will achieve it. But I come back to the point, to take it to the Soviet Union, for example, which is very well recognized over there. Nothing that Gorbachev is proposing can be achieved, and we will lose him as a proponent of global collaboration, unless he manages to reduce his defense budget. Without that, what he has is voodoo perestroika. And they are very aware of that. But they are also, and they're going to do a lot unilaterally, I believe, but he's limited in how far he could go. That's why we needed a candidate who would respond to his proposals for these mutual cuts. Dukakis always looked to me more likely to that, though who can say? Because as you may have noticed, he was not able to bring himself in his campaign to talk at all, either about collaboration or about reducing the defense budget. And I think to believe that that in office he would have shaken free of the constraints that that bound him during the campaign was not to count on very much. So it does depend on us. I do want to mention the one other thing then that affects our globe, our culture, that constrains these people. Another aspect that we needed for this this global buildup that we've had, or the US buildup in the Cold War, was the militarism that we've been hearing about from Archie. I totally agree with all that. I want to mention one aspect of that that hasn't been mentioned enough, I think. The militarism was necessary for the buildup, and what underlies the militarism is what has always underlied militarism for thousands of years, and that is male domination. That is an ethic of machismo. The demonstration of the general principle of hierarchy and separation and enemyhood in the form of so-called male values, warlike values, and male domination. I recommend, by the way, to all of you who don't know it, Rian Eisler's book, The Chalice and the Blade, if you want to know how far back this goes, and also its religious roots. That suggests something that can be done right now. If we're to do what my friend Michael Clare once said years ago, as he defined our problem, to combat or to transcend the hegemony, the cultural hegemony of militarism, that's a target that is all around, and wherever we are, we can struggle usefully against it. And in terms of this one specific point I'm making, I think the point that has been on the struggle that's being waged in the churches right now to combat in the Catholic Church, in the Episcopal Church, and a number of other churches, those aspects of those religions that have defined them as religions of male domination for 2,000 years are very hopeful signs on the one hand and need to be backed very much. A little more broadly, Reagan's whole scheme for 8 years, now epitomized by the Bush campaign, concentrated and focused, is the inculcation of machismo, the standing tall, the so-called male values. That has to be challenged now much more than it has been. As I say, Bush raised it to the point of absurdity in this particular campaign, and won with it. We really can't go on with a man being able to win with that campaign.